from a female perspective, I guess, have you ever considered what the posse might look like were you a man?
Well, you know, that's a really good question, because years ago I read a book. I think her name is Jean Shinoda Bodin, Gods in Every Man. And that was the first thing that I think the seed that got planted. This is years and years and years ago. And it was about looking at male character types for men. And so I did the work first on my animus, on my male self. And then I read Goddesses in Every Woman. But I did Gods in Every Man first. And sometimes being in touch with the male sides of myself as a musician, that's where and how I play that out. Because as a performer, I look to Freddie Mercury, Jimi Hendrix. A performer, I've gone to the male rock gods more than the women, because I love the women songwriters. But as performers, for me, they haven't been the thing that really, I don't know, made me want to emulate that. And I thought, well, there's no female that's pulling a Jimi Hendrix at the piano, and I'm going to do it. But you have to be able to plug into that, and you have to be able to access that mojo. And women, traditionally, we've been really kept back being able to plug into our dark prince. So many women, I'm sure you've seen this, will go off trying to chase the guy that everybody knows is going to really use her. But she's trying to access that Luciferian dark prince energy, but on the outside instead of creatively on the inside. I mean, I've done that before. I've been drawn to men that, number one, aren't really interested in women because they're just there to be voyeurs and watch them do terrible things to themselves. I mean, we can talk about all those kinds of things, but we don't need to go into detail. And you wonder, well, why do men need to do that? They need to feel powerful by seeing a woman disempowered. And so musically, I've really allowed myself as a woman to feel like I've got a big 12-inch.
Mm. Well, I was going to say, it can sort of replicate that male rock icon sort of performance without coming across as being masculine.
Right.
Which I think is great.
But having done the work, it's not as if I haven't tried to discover what male character types live inside me, because I think you have to do that so that you're not always trying to go out with the guy that is really your own inner male. And that's helped me. The guys that I was attracted to in my teens or in my younger years is very different than who I find attractive now, because I kind of know the male inside me.
I was talking to a colleague the other day about, it was a very shallow question, but what would your style be were you of the opposite sex? And it's something I guess you could answer quite quickly, but I think it's something that the image you project is based a lot on what's inside, and it's difficult to tap that sort of my inner female, I guess. I thought I could answer that question quite easily, but then as I got to think about it, I really don't know what kind of image I would have as a female. Would I be extremely conservative? Would I can't see myself as a female. Does that make sense to you?
No, it does. I think because you don't have the hormones. And I don't, you know, Mark and I have had these conversations. We'll sit there and talk about how men think, how women think. And I will ask him a question about, well, do you think she's hot? And he'd say, well, no. And my male self might think a woman is hot, but he's not attracted to her. So I don't have a guy's juice inside me. So I don't know what I would be attracted to in women, because it's easy for me to say what I think is attractive when the truth is I might just want to be able to get into her outfit. Who knows what I'm thinking? But when I'm performing, it's a very different thing. Because as a musician, that word musician is not male or female. It's a creative force. And so when I'm playing, especially with the band and the guys, I'm a woman playing with them, but I'm a musician, and that transcends any kind of sexuality.
After this tour, do you see any of the posse working their way into future tours?
Well, you know, you're asking me a very... I know it's an important question, and I know that we're making a live DVD of this tour, and I'm happy about that, because if nothing else, when Tash is a mom, I think it's great if she can show her children what Granny did.
Well, what is her take on this now? Does she just see it as mommy's doing dress-ups, or have you explained to her the whole concept?
No, she knows. She understood it before anybody did. She talks about Clyde and Isabel Pip, and she knows that I go into it's a performance piece and I step into it, but she sees them not as mom. You know, they have their own story. But she, you know, kids are very in tune with role-playing. And so this is not a big stretch for them. We're the ones as adults that cut ourselves off and think, ooh, I've made this choice because I do this for a job. This is who I am. And that's completely the wrong way around. What you do for a job, you do that for a job. And that's one side of yourself. But there are many other sides that you have to allow to express themselves. Or you find yourself frustrated and shaving your head somewhere in Tarzana. I mean, I just use that as an example because everybody knows it. But there is a reason you can get to that point. When you deny who you are, who you are, who you are to yourself, then finally you melt down because you can't live a lie. But there's so many sides to a person. There's plenty to choose from. You just have to allow yourself to do it, or I think they start fighting and clawing their way out, and they take over in a strange way. But to answer your question, it's going to be hard to say goodbye to the posse, and yet I know every good story has to come to an end. So there has to be an ending. I mean, it can't be like Rocky VII. I mean, I know that.
And finally, have you started writing for the next time?
Oh, no, I can't.
you can't maintain this.
That's so far away in my mind, creatively. I'm here and I'm present with this.
So the DVD is, do you see it as essentially being a way for fans to have seen all the characters who may not have gone to any more than one show, I guess?
Well, yeah, and it's also a documentation of a work. I think that it's a... you're able to really put it on an experience, because once we've done that, we can never do it again. You know, once the posse's done their world tour and they've maybe had some few extra songs that come out with the DVD, maybe, we'll see, then they have to go on and lead their life in other ways.
Mm-hmm. It's a bit like an anti-Spice Girls, you might say.
Yeah, no, we can't have a 10-year reunion of the posse. I don't think we can do that.
Okay, is that on the record now?
Well, I don't know. I guess I can be seduced into anything.
They might have different styles 10 years down the track.
Oh, who knows? Lots of plastic surgery.
Maybe a shaved head somewhere.
I don't know.